Ask an AT User panel. My name is Joanna Blackwell, and I'm an accessibility specialist with the Texas Workforce Commission. This morning, I'm joined by a talented group of assistive technology users who also work at the Texas Workforce Commission, and joined by my coworker, Christina Miranda. Chris?
Hi, good morning, everybody. My name is Chris Miranda. I'm also an accessibility specialist, and I am the curriculum developer and training specialist. We have a panel of five people here, and we're gonna start with George and introduce yourself. I'm gonna pass the mic to you, George.
Good morning. My name is George Batiste. I'm a vocational rehab teacher, been with the agency for about 17 and a half years. I come up here from Houston, Texas, which is in Region 5 of the Tech Horse Commission.
Hello, my name is Ernesto Cifuentes. I'm a web accessibility specialist for Texas Workforce Commission, and I'll pass it on to
you. All right. Hello, I'm Belinda Lane. I am in the Vocational Rehabilitation Division of the Texas Workforce Commission. I'm the Vocational Rehabilitation Teacher and Braille Program Specialist, and I work with our teachers in order to train our customers to learn their skills and be able to get jobs of their choosing and live independent lives.
Good morning. My name is Andrew De Avila. I also work with Texas Workforce Commission, but under that umbrella, I work at the Chris Cole Rehabilitation Center for the Blind, and I'm an assistive technology instructor, and just recently got my master's in assistive technology from Northern Arizona, and we teach adults who are new to blindness all the skills to become independent, and I teach the technology portion of that.
My name is Kevin Ratliff, and I also work for TWC and for Chris Cole. I've been a technology instructor or assistive technology instructor at Chris Cole for 10 years.
And this is Joanna Blackwell again. I have worked at Texas Workforce Commission as an accessibility specialist. And I actually do have one other question for everybody here on the panel. And I guess I'll go ahead and get started. And that's about what assistive technologies you use in your personal and in your work life. So for those of you in the audience who can see, you may notice that I have Apple AirPods in my ears and I have an iPhone in front of me. That's because I'm using the VoiceOver screen reader to read some of the questions that we have for the panelists today. So in addition to using VoiceOver on iPhone, I use it on macOS. And I also use the JAWS screen reader, the Narrator screen reader, and the NVDA screen reader. There are a couple that have screen readers that have gone the way of the Dodo that I don't use anymore, but I've been around in the AT world for quite a while, so that's what I use when it comes to assistive technology. And I'm going to hand the microphone back over to Kevin.
Okay, so this is Kevin Ratliff, and I have my Samsung computer here. It's a mainstream device, but I use JAWS and Narrator on it. I have various Android devices. I use Pixel 6 Pro for my daily driver, and I also have Samsung Galaxy S22 for work and personal. And I have all of their accessories, watches, headphones, and I use TalkBack on my Google and Samsung phone, and I use Chromebox on my Chromebook. I have a Pixel Book Go that I use daily or almost daily, and I think that's just about all the assistive technology that I have.
Good morning. This is Andrew Davila. And I'm actually opposite of Kevin. Kevin's our Android guy at the center. And so I use everything Apple, Mac OS, iPad OS. And I also use JAWS, Job Access with Speech, NVDA Narrator as well. I'm currently going for my PhD, so I kind of have to jump between different platforms to see which one works better with either Mac OS or with Windows. But us being, Kevin and I, us being instructors teaching people coming into the center, we kind of have to keep up with the latest technology, and everybody wants to learn the latest trends and how to become YouTubers or podcasters. So Kevin and I are part of a large group where we kind of have to keep up with everything and test everything. So that's pretty much it, I guess. Belinda?
It's Belinda again, and I use a lot of the similar things that Kevin and Joanne and Andrew do. On my computer, I use the JAWS screen reader and Narrator in a pinch. I have Apple phone products. I use an Apple Watch. I use the VoiceOver on both products. Let's see, I use a Braille note taker and Braille displays. I have one to show and tell later. Y'all can come up and look after the talk. Let's see, and in the workplace, use all of those at home. I also use JAWS on my computer. I have a Surface that I use, and anything that has screen reader on it, I will use. I have a TiVo for my television. That way I can read the guide, the TV guide, and access all of the recordings I have. Let's see, what else? Anything that will talk, I use. I have a reader for medication. There are readers for money, but I use the phone, many, many phone apps I use to access different things. Ira, I use for its live description, so to speak. So if I need to set my washer and dryer, I can call them up real quick and say, hey, you know, what is this set at? Directions. I know George got directions using Ira to get to this building. So many other things, and I'm sure George and Ernesto will tap on those too.
Hi, Ernesto again. So work-wise, I use Windows with JAWS and Windows Magnifier. Found that basically I can do all my testing or my work. For play, usually use the iPhone or all iPhone or Apple products. With VoiceOver or screen magnifier. George.
Okay. I kind of use a little bit of everything that everyone else has already mentioned. The screen reader with JAWS on the computer, desktop or laptop. I also have a note taker. I'm transitioning slowly from using an old Apex because it still works, but it's dying. So it's telling me it's time for the quick, but I do have a Braille Note Touch Plus, which is another note taker with a Braille display, but instead of having a QWERTY keyboard, it has a Braille typewriter keyboard, but we can use a Bluetooth keyboard if we really like using QWERTY to pair it to it. I also, as you guys see, I have an iPhone in front of me as well with headphones connected to it. So I do use VoiceOver, and I've used VoiceOver on an iPad, but I don't use an iPad that much. And I have also used, okay, just thought all over. But anyway, I also use an embosser when I'm at the office because I'm a Braille reader primarily, especially I tend to retain information if I read it with my fingertips than listening to it with my ears. I use it as a comparison to, as I notice a lot of people with 20/20 vision, if they have to read a lot, they will print it because I guess they read better when something is on paper than staring at a visual screen. So that's why I tend to, if I got to read a lot and I want to memorize it a lot, I will send it to the embosser and emboss it onto, you know, like a hard copy. And just like my note taker, it has a braille display and I use that a lot. And lastly, I also use, and I'm sure everybody uses this, these smart speakers. When you're talking to you, Alexa, or somebody might have an Alexa at home, so now I've just activated it. So I use the Amazon Echo devices as well as the Google Play thing on a daily basis. And besides Ira, like Linda mentioned, I would also use Be My Eyes. I use everything. Whatever's available to me, I'm going to use it. And since I am a teacher, I also introduce and teach these things as well. That's how they can use it, along with the various amounts of apps that are available. I'm done. I don't know who I
get. Okay, thank you. Next. Thank you, George. This is Chris Miranda again. So what we're going to do is we've got some questions that we pre-prepared for the panelists, but what we really want to do is have you guys ask the questions. Anything, this is your chance to ask a user of assistive technology any questions that you have that you might want, you know, some insight into how they use either an app or a program or the assistive tech. So I'm just going to start off with the first question, and the panelists will raise their hands if they want to answer it, and then I'll just call on them. Okay. So the first question is, can you share an unexpected way that mobile or web technology has facilitated your independence or enhanced your daily experience? I see that hand going up, Kevin. It's all yours.
Here you go.
Mine is because this question is just seeing where assistive technology has come from, imagining, you know, what I was going to do to live independently, how I was going to pay bills, and then to see those technologies, you know, come to fruition, to be able to pay bills online, to be able to, you know, cut or write checks, you know, through online banking, to be able to do so many things, all the way up to Ira and Be My Eyes and Lookout, which is computer-based assistive technology. But just to go from thinking, you know, being totally blind as a kid, you know, how am I going to do these things, you know, independently? And then the technology just, you know, came along kind of right at the right time.
All right, Joanna.
Thanks, Chris. So I'm sure everyone here has heard of ChatGPT, and I'm calling this a web application because it's a website. And it's incredible in what it can do when it comes to describing images. I'm a reader. I love to read audiobooks. I was formerly sighted, so I used to read print books, but now that I don't do that, I can read audiobooks. But I remember loving just to look at the book covers. And so I ask ChatGPT to describe a book cover to me, or I've asked it to describe actors. I'm just curious about what they look like. So this is something, I could see it helping in education, but I'm not taking any university classes right now, but I could see it being useful in that. But just for me to be able to ask it to describe a book cover and get an answer is pretty incredible and has really enhanced my enjoyment of things that I like to do in my personal life. And I have used ChatGPT in my work life too, not for it to do my work, but sometimes to give me a different angle to think about how I might want to approach a certain topic or a subject. So I found it really helpful in that regard.
And this is Belinda. And kind of to add to that, the enjoyment of entertainment, I really, really love the audio description. Audio description is movies, TV shows, and it's somebody describing the visual aspects that we don't see. And this truly is an enhancement. You get to have those things like, say somebody's receives a letter and they read it, but just silently, and all that you see is the letter on the screen. So the audio describer will read the letter so you know what happened. And just little subtle things. One of the movies I watched a long time ago that really kind of showed me the benefit and the impact it has is Unbreakable, I think is the name of the movie with Bruce Willis. Yes, excellent. And what happened was in the beginning, Bruce's character is getting on the train or the subway, and he steps on there and he sees an empty seat next to an attractive woman. He takes off his wedding ring and goes and sits down next to her. And do you know how devastating that was to me? Because I love Bruce Willis. And I thought, what a cad. So, I mean, you get to know these things and you're not just going around with your rose-colored glasses. Oh, he's so wonderful. But anyway, so I love that. And, you know, there's even live description. The coronation over the weekend was described. So you can know that they may describe, oh, the, you know, the crown has these jewels, blah, blah, blah. It's really neat. And I almost, well, I must confess, I do steer away from movies and things that aren't described because it's like, oh, what happened, you know? So I save those to hang out with friends to watch, and otherwise I do that. So it's really great.
Andrew?
This is Andrew again. I would also agree with everyone here. It's definitely changed my life. I was diagnosed with retinitis pigmentosa my senior year of high school, and I did struggle. I couldn't see the screens. I couldn't see text. But when the Apple iPhone came out with VoiceOver, it definitely changed my life because it allowed me to meet my wife. You know, I spoke to her in person, but I was able to, you know, text her, email her, send her pictures. I jokingly tell her I lost my sight, but not my game. But I was able to do that with VoiceOver, and I didn't do very well my senior year in high school, but it's allowed me to go back to college. Like Joanna was saying, with ChatGPT, I took a doctoral course I just finished yesterday, and it was an applied behavioral analysis single subject design class. And I used ChatGPT to describe these inaccessible charts and graphs where there weren't any plot points, but it was like a wavy or squiggly line. And I'd upload the picture, ask it questions, and it would describe it to me. And I didn't have to rely on, you know, like someone with sight, like my wife, or just anyone just having to just sit next to me and describe it, when I just could sit on my laptop and have this do this for me. And technology is just, it's coming a long way. And a lot of people are scared of it, but it's actually becoming more more accessible for people with visual impairments. There's a person who took a picture of the inside of the refrigerator and asked it, can you make me a dinner recipe with these ingredients? And sure enough, it gave this person a dinner recipe with the stuff that's in his fridge. And that can definitely help someone like myself or people on the panel up here, because, you know, sometimes we're having to do the smell test or look at things or what is this? And in technology is kind of helping us out in education, employment. So I'm actually kind of excited to see where this goes.
I think George wanted to add. Oh, pass it down to George, please. Andrew. There.
I basically just want to give a little bit more insight on what Belinda was talking about with the descriptive video. Because movies is my hobby. Every once in a while, I like to escape into someone else's imagination with all of the stuff that, you know, we deal with on a regular basis. That's what I call it. So I enjoy movies. And back in, I was like maybe 30 years ago, AMC was like one of the first chain of theaters that I knew had offered this type of service. But it was only available a week later after the movie had come out and only on one screen. And we used to have to call like the manager and make reservations to ask him, can this movie be put in the descriptive video house? Because every movie didn't have that available. Well, since as time has passed, now almost all the national chains offer this service to AMC, to Cinemark, to Regal, and some others I can't think of right now. And because of technology, they now have incorporated into the digital system that when a movie is first released, not only is it available with descriptive video now, so it means when a movie first come out, like I think what just came out, not Marvel, it's another one. Oh, I cannot think of it. I just saw the thing. That's terrible. Well, anyway, it'll come to me when I put the mic down. But anyway, it allowed me to take my 15-year-old to that movie. I don't have to wait to make a reservations. And the devices are available right when for multiple screens. Like there are some theaters, they have to program it for that particular house. This one theater that I go to now, they just have a headset that is equipped with both hearing impaired as well, I mean, hard of hearing as well as descriptive video. So you could turn one knob up for it to get the description and one knob up in case you are hard of hearing. And I can go into any house. I don't have to go back, program this device to this movie. They have it available to whatever house that you're in, whatever movie you want to see. It will be available with that. And it also is now available if anybody, I'm sure a lot of us have Netflix, that if you go to the language selection, you can choose audio description right there and you still have your visual, but as now you can also get the description. So that's with everybody. So I actually want to challenge those of you in the audience and those of you watching online, if you have like Netflix, just give it a try and see what it's like. Close your eyes and see how, with the exception of descriptive video, has now allowed us to say, those who don't have vision, yes, we also watch movies.
I just wanted to make a comment on that too. It's that inclusivity. It really makes you feel great that you can just go like anyone else and see the movie at the same time as anyone else and have what you need to enjoy it to its fullest. I know, kind of similar to George, our Regal Cinema here would show the descriptive video. You either had to go to the matinee, the very first one, or the last one. And it's like, I don't want to go there with all the kids. And, you know, that's beyond my bedtime. So it's great. It's offered it every showing of the movie all day.
Guardians of the Galaxy.
Thank you, guys. This is Chris again, and just wanted to give the audience a chance to ask any questions to the panel. If you guys, you know, there we go.
I'll also note that for online users, if you go to the reactions button and raise your hand, we'll unmute you and allow you to ask your question as well.
Hello, it's on. The question is about the apps and whatnot that you rely on. I mean, you mentioned many pieces of software. Some are very high profile, like screen readers, but some are more niche, like a custom app to read medication or money or whatever the case may be. And I'm wondering if you've ever relied on an app and then had it let you down, you know, because sometimes apps don't get maintained or they get discontinued completely. So have you had any experiences like that?
Yes, that's a, you know, it can only go so far. That's why we use so many different things. One of the other apps I use is Seeing AI, and it's similar to the IRA that has the description, but it's more like an OCR. So I can, when I want to know, okay, is this can of beans or is it my peaches or whatever, you can scan and it'll read you whatever the label is. And it also has the ability to read the QR code if necessary. Sometimes it's terribly slow and you just want it now. And then sometimes it just won't do it at all, depending on what maybe the material is shiny or, you know, all kinds of things. So yes, we do encounter those drawbacks. And one of my main pet peeves, and this is just, I don't think it has anything to do with accessibility, or maybe it does, but gosh, when you make the hardware and you turn it on, make it do a beep or a sound. All it is, oh, is the light on? Well, I don't know. And it, and especially cable companies, it's the worst. TVs are horrible. So you have to lift up your seeing AI and see, is the thing on or off? But yeah, who wants to go next? George?
I actually am someone who don't have any vision at all, and I do my own grocery shopping. And I don't have it delivered to me. I actually go into the store to get the stuff myself, because when I'm shopping, I like to put my hands on it. I mean, I can get like a written description, but to me, it's still not the same when you put my hand on it. Now, the two drawbacks that can occur is I can go into a particular store, and if I'm going to use Ira or Be My Eyes, I may get poor cell reception, and sometimes it breaks up. And so I lose that part of the service they're providing to me, because they may be either a lag, meaning they probably don't get the image to them for like maybe 5 or 6 seconds down the line, or they just lose the visual, be frozen. And so that can happen. Or if I'm using the CNAI app and using the product portion of the app, which means it'll scan the sticker and it'll tell me like if I'm getting like a pack of ground meat, you know, how many pounds it is and what the ingredients are. If the sticker is kind of old or have gotten wet or been rubbed out, it'll tell me not recognized. And so now if I'm at a particular facility that do not provide assisted shopper, then I have to either interrupt another customer who's shopping or just wait till I get to the checkout and ask the cashier, does this say so-and-so? And depending on what store I'm going to, depending on how busy it is, they probably would go and get me exactly what I need, or I may just have to come back a second time. So those are some of the drawbacks of the apps that we use to enhance our independence that could probably fail us at an unopportune time.
Joanna?
Thank you. Yes. There are apps that are very useful or have been very useful, and then they do go away. Maybe the developer just can't sustain the app anymore because they're not getting paid, or there's just some other reason the app, you know, just goes away. And as assistive technology users, especially as blind assistive technology users, we know we can't always count on our technology. We love our technology, but we do have to have other methods. And I know a lot of people here on the panel, we have other means of identifying information. There's, even if you're not a very good Braille reader, you can have Braille labels to figure, you know, what is this, what's in this can or what's in this box. But when it comes to the apps, we may have our favorites, but for me, I'm always looking out for what's new, what's coming. And that way I have more than one option. I can either use Seeing AI, or I can use many other apps. I can use Ira if I'm doing work. So it's important for us, and we know, we wish it wasn't this way, but we always have to have more than one option, even when it comes to screen readers. And I'd like to emphasize that I think the most important things for people who are developers, people who are creating these apps, is just to make sure you are making your apps accessible, because if you don't, then it's just another thing we have to find a workaround for. And that is, it seems like that's our whole life, finding workarounds for things that are inaccessible. So if you can remove that barrier, maybe it's just a tiny barrier, like there's a button that's unlabeled or an image that's not, doesn't have alt text. If you could just add those things and make it our lives easier, we appreciate it so much, because it can be a struggle. We have alternative methods, but you know, sometimes life is kind of a headache when you have to always find a workaround.
This is Ernesto. Some of those workarounds sometimes are interesting. So, you know, I'll use Uber or something like that to grab a ride. And sometimes it's a mixture of technology, because it's just not Uber. It's also cellular companies that provide the bandwidth or limit the bandwidth. So
And in some instances, I can get stuck somewhere until, you know, you can try to problem solve. Maybe it's my phone. I need to reboot. No, that's not that. It says I've got two bars. Why cannot get, you know, why am I not getting through? Is it really them? But the other services are working. So sometimes you have to move over to another service, or it seems sometimes like some specific things just don't work because something is being blocked or something. And sometimes you just kind of wait. There's no way, no workaround. On another note, when we have applications like Belinda was saying, we have like CNA, I believe you mentioned, exactly what Joanna said. We're always looking out for other applications such as Apple, their phone. I mean, they're when you take a photo now, you have VoiceOver running. If you keep your finger and tap on it, let it keep reading, it will describe the image and describe text that's on there. So usually I take a lot of photos of documents. And so I have a library of documents on my phone. This is unusual, I guess, photo album now. But if I'm looking at something, maybe for work, sometimes some things are a little weird. For a while, the color analyzer wasn't working with magnification. The newest version now works with that. So it's good. It's actually they released a second upgrade after the first one. The one that was working. So you find that things get better or start working, which is great. So, and what I mean with color analyze, can't speak now. Analyzer, gosh, shaking my head. Anyways, that it'll work with the magnification as it's got its own little magnification system in it. So it's like two things moving. It's kind of interesting and fun. It's a game to always learn something. That's all I got.
We have a question in the audience.
We're going to take one online first.
Okay.
If that's okay. So will you unmute, Caroline?
Yeah, I'm not sure which question to prioritize because I have lots, but thank you so much for being here, sharing your experiences. I guess I'll ask my questions on alt text and screen readers, since it seems like a number of you use that technology. I often write book titles, and I'm wondering, this is a multi-part question. So part one, does capitalization in a book title make any difference to the screen reader if like each word is capitalized versus just the first one? Same with if there's quotation marks around the book title, does that make a difference? My second alt text E question is if you're writing a time signature, for example, like this event is 6:15 to 8:15, or text reads because you're doing alt text for a poster, what's the best way to write those numbers and like the dash between them and the hyphens so that they're read correctly? Yeah, those are two to start with. Thanks.
Hi, Joanna.
So to talk about your first question about capitalization and quotation marks, it usually doesn't make a difference. The quotation marks may or may not read depending on the settings that the user has set for their screen reader. On what we call the beginner level, it will read those, but a lot of people have changed that. So if the quotation marks are important, you'll want to include them because as screen reader users, we can read character by character, word by word. Now, something that is very important to note is if there's a hashtag, if all the letters are not capital, or I should say, if all the words are not capitalized, most screen readers will just read it as kind of gobbledygook because it doesn't know where one word ends and the other begins. So for hashtags, I think capitalization is important. So that's one thing to keep in mind. But as for the titles and the other part of your question, it shouldn't matter if you capitalize or don't capitalize. Of course, if the book title is actually capitalized, the letters are capitalized, I'm not quite sure why you wouldn't capitalize it. You want it to represent whatever is actually shown in the printed text. So that would be important. And the other question was about, I'm forgetting the other question. Could you repeat your second?
Specifically timestamps for like an event.
Yeah. So you should usually be able to write the times. So if it's, let's say 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., I usually just type out 6:00-8:00 p.m. And then if there's Central Time or Eastern Time, whatever, just put that as well. And that should read just fine. Instead of a dash, you could write TO to 6 to 8 p.m., for example. And that works for me. Anyone else want to add?
Yes. This is Ernesto. So periods, commas do make a difference. There is a slight pause. It does change the way it says things. As for dates, I'd rather have an actual, you know, March 2nd rather than a number, something that you can hear audibly well. Just that's my 2 cents.
I got 2 cents. George has one.
Just one.
A lot of, not only us, but even sighted people, when they are sending a text message on a phone, sometimes they may type or they may dictate. And usually when I receive text messages, I can tell if someone has dictated, whether they're going to speak punctuations or they're just talking. Because when they're just talking, it makes it one big long run-on sentence that the screen reader, the voiceover is just reading. But somebody like me, who's mindful of that because I was a journalist major, even if I'm going to dictate, if I choose to dictate, I actually will speak the punctuation so that it will look like real sentences. And if I happen to put timestamps in, like meet me for lunch at 12:30 p.m., I will have to go back and probably put one, two, and put a colon between the two and the zero. I mean, the two and the three. So it will say 12:39, 1230. So that's where the colon comes in play, that if you're writing something, if you want, if anybody's going to be using like a screen reader to read that, those are important for it to read out loud so they would enunciate it correctly.
Yes, I agree with that. And one rule of thumb, I think, for alt text, you know, if you're describing something, is keep it simple. You don't need a whole lot, but it needs to capture what you're trying to describe. And as far as formatting of numbers and such, using the appropriate formats, like for instance, phone numbers, it's irritating to see area code 512.231.0867. The hyphens sound better when you, when your screen reader reads it. It reads it as a phone number rather than an IP address. Also, in the case, the example of the book title, like Joanna said, just write whatever. Well, if it's already there, you're reading it. But so the capitals, unless it's just something, I don't really care what the font is. You know, I know that the title, Gone with the Wind, I don't need to know that. You know, the wind looks, the word wind looks like a gust of wind. Well, maybe some people like that. I don't know. But keeping it simple, and like George said, use the punctuation. If you are describing something, make sure you do put a period in there so that there is that pause, things like that.
All right, Drew.
Yeah. Yeah, and to touch on everyone, what everyone has said also, using your tools in your ribbon are actually very helpful, inserting those date and timestamps, the numbering. I know me going back to school, reading long texts, I know you're labeling your headings, your heading level ones, twos, and threes. That's actually very helpful with someone using screen reading software. We actually have control over what we want to read using, say, job access to speech, JAWS. We could have it read some, most, or none on punctuation. But we have control over, you know, how we want to customize that reading. But making sure that you do it, though, on the front end is going to be very helpful, those periods, those commas. But if you're wondering, like, well, is this going to be accessible? A lot of times just using the tools in your ribbon, inserting those numbers that way, the dates, the times, majority of the time, the screen reading software will read that in Microsoft Word. Kevin, I don't know if you wanted to touch anything.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Thanks. Belinda, did you have something else? Okay. I just wanted to add on for the alt text, and we'll get to you next. Okay. From my experience, I've seen that in the alt text, I've seen people actually put instructions in there. And if this is still true, you guys, but the screen reader reads the alt text all at once. There's no reading word by word. So you can't stop it to pause and go, okay, and then the next. So you don't want to do that. You want to put a succinct description, and you can put a lot of, you can make the description really describe the photo, and you can make it shorter by not adding this is an image of, just write what it is. Yeah. But just remember that the screen reader will read it all at once. So can we, I don't know if we, yeah.
Thank you so much for all your great answers today. My name is Maddie. I'm a cisgendered white woman with brown hair and glasses. I am asking this question from the position of hoping to get into auditing websites and apps. So I'm very curious to know which industries are doing, creating really accessible and usable websites and apps, and which aren't. I'd love to hear, which industry to go into to start auditing websites for usability. Thank you.
Oh, Joanna.
So that's a hard question to answer. Which industry is doing a good job of making accessible websites? It runs the gamut across all industries. Some companies are good and some companies are not good, and it really doesn't matter what industry it's in. I've seen good banking websites and terrible banking websites, good shopping sites and terrible shopping sites, and everything along that line from good to very bad. So I don't know that I can answer that question. Do we have anyone else
who wants to talk just,
about it? Oh, Kevin.
This is Ernesto. Maybe a couple that I've just seen them do a really good job, actually HEB, which is local to Austin and most of Texas, I guess lower Texas and stuff. They have, their app is amazing. They actually do a pretty good job. I don't like shopping. I don't like going to a grocery store because it's really difficult to find a can or something. I got to go by color. I don't go by words. So I got to look at this general symbol or the pattern it'll build over and over. That's what I'm looking for when I'm shopping. And it's so having an app like that, it's just great. They do a really simple, straightforward job of ordering food. Banking, that's the gamut. Can't really, even Amazon's done some terrible things here and there, but then they fix it. They're always kind of messing around with the website. Audible, I always like what Audible is doing or from the past, and they've done the same. Of course, Amazon now owns that. Does anybody have some other thoughts?
Okay.
That was like Joanna said, it kind of spans the gamut. I do a lot of usability testing, and so the industries that I've noticed that kind of tend to pay a little more attention is banking, insurance. So most of the, what we would consider, I guess, major banks tend to at least give a nod toward accessibility. They probably have some user testers. I've used Chase and Bank of America. I've used Wells Fargo with no problem at all. Each might have a different approach, but they are trying to make the app user-friendly and accessible, which sometimes the website might be user accessible, but not so user-friendly, like an Amazon. It's just too huge. But then other websites, other companies will have an alternative site. So sometimes you go to the mobile version of the site, or Amazon has like an accessible version of you know, their site. And then they might also have something like disability support where you can just call in if, you know, you're not able to manage it with your screen reader. But I've done a lot of testing for insurance sites, big and small, or, you know, large and small, shopping, HEB, Kroger, different things like that. They have lots of other things that are helpful to the mainstream as well, like, you know, instructions, like preparation instructions and things like that. So it does span the gamut, but the insurance, the banking, medical, I've seen more of those websites try to, you know, those companies try to make sure that their site is both accessible and user friendly, or, you know, they care about the usability as well.
This is Belinda, and I agree. So the banking industry has some very good ones, more better than the others. All the credit card companies have an app, and their websites are really good. Discover, American Express. I have them all on my phone. You can do everything with the phone now, and it's very accessible. The medical, which Kevin just touched on, a lot of those are really good too. Nowadays, go to our patient portal, everything you have to do online now. And luckily they are making them pretty accessible. And that's really neat to be able to go into one of your patient portal sites and independently and confidentially look at your own information. You know, test results, if you want to look at the test results, or your doctor may comment on things. So that is a really neat advancement in that industry, I think. Now, there are shortcomings. Sometimes the whole thing will be perfectly accessible until you get to one spot. And I have to find one of my sons or somebody who can say, hey, can you make this move on? Because now I'm stuck. And it's a visual thing, especially those, what are they called? You know, the CAPTCHAs. Those are a nightmare. And they say, oh, here, use an Audible one instead. And then, well, what part of the Audible do I use? Do I use the garbly stuff? Where does it end? And I'm kind of thinking maybe if you just put anything in there, it takes it. So I don't know. Maybe I've cracked the code, because if it says the number ones are hard because I have to write them down, 7, 6, 3 and 4, 5. And sometimes I might leave off one and it still works. So I don't know. But just sometimes the whole thing isn't quite there. The entertainment industry has come a long way. The apps, Disney Plus is fabulous, Netflix, Peacock is a nightmare, HBO Plus, another nightmare, but what was the other one? And the reason they're nightmares is because you have to swipe 100 billion times to get anywhere. And like Andrew or Kevin said, the headings really help, even in the apps. If you can jump from heading to heading, that really, really helps the experience.
Do we have any questions from the...
We do. Let's ask Jane to unmute.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to point out that there are a ton of wonderful questions in the meeting chat, and I hope we'll get a chance to get to some of those. The question I want to throw out, we've been talking a lot about ChatGPT, and one of the things, I was doing a presentation last week, and I was trying a number of different auto alt text generation strategies for ChatGPT, using variations of ChatGPT. And I found that for abstract things like pictures, either it was so vague as to be unusable, or it was just plain wrong. And with a lot of promotion of ChatGPT as an alt-text solution, I was wondering what your experiences and thoughts were on that.
Joe?
Yes, we have had experience with image description before ChatGPT, like Ernesto was saying, with Apple and how it will describe photos to you. But it makes mistakes. Ever since President Trump was in office and then Biden became president, it kept identifying Biden as Trump. It said, President Trump standing at a podium. And of course, that's not right. So we know there are problems, there are issues. So as with anything, for people who are blind, we know sometimes we have to double check. If something seems a little off, we know we may not be able to trust it. But that being said, it does often do a good job. Like, just imagine somebody put a blindfold on you and they handed you a picture and say, hey, here's this picture and it's got a tree in it. But then imagine you put it in your iPhone and then voiceover say, this is a pine tree with a mountain in the background. That's amazing. So even that incremental that increase in the amount of detail we get is really incredible. So I think as blind people, we know we can't, I think we've all been taught and we know that we can't trust technology all the way. But I think the way it's going in the future, the smarter the AI gets, the more we will be able to trust it. But there's probably always going to be a need for human intervention. So I think it's fine for, personally, I think it would be fine to use something like a ChatGPT to make a description, but then you definitely want to check it with your human knowledge and see if, is this correct or not? Now, I would like to say we do like alt text to be simple, but this is my personal preference. I love as much detail as I can get about an image because it's really a personal thing. But for me, even though I'm blind, I'm a visual learner. The more detail you can give me about how something looks visually, the happier I am. So that's just my personal preference. And so obviously not all AT users are the same. And it's really... it would be nice if there were options, like here's a simple description, here's more detail. And this brings to my mind, and it's sort of related to ChatGPT, there's an app out there called Be My Eyes, and they're actually working on something called a virtual volunteer, and they're going to be using ChatGPT, where you can take a picture of, let's say, a box dinner or something like that. And it will tell you what that box dinner is. You can ask it questions like, what's the nutritional info? How do I cook this? And it will answer from the pictures that you took of that box, which is super incredible. So personally, I'm very excited about these options that are going to be available to us soon. But as always, we have to be careful not to put all of our trust in technology. So I know that was a very long answer. Anyone else want to take this one?
This is Ernesto, just real quick. So as these newer models get better at describing, and you know, you're going to find some that we're going to work a lot better. Some of the things that are coming up that are really interesting is, so if you have a picture, I know this is more about alt text, but if you have a picture and you want to look, let's say you want to investigate the picture a little bit more, so it'll give you a general idea what the picture is about, is that you actually interact with the picture. Oh, what's in the background? Oh, so there's trees. What kind of trees are those? And it starts identifying a little bit more information. And that's what's really interesting about some of this technology, is that you can get a general idea of what's going on and then focus in on the maybe a table off to the right and people are eating or something like that. And then it starts describing some of the people. Now that's really interesting, I think, for a blind user, because you realize there's another world going on that you captured somehow in that photo.
And this is Kevin. I have had a lot of luck with the automatic, with the image descriptions built into Chrome and to Edge. And being able to check them against, you know, a couple of other sources or maybe someone cited. So obviously I can't upload, you know, every picture that I have to that service, but using that has been, so I haven't had a lot of experience with the chat GPT. I've used the Google Bard for some things, but not for so much for the image descriptions. But another thing that has been impressive is if I double tap and hold and go to details on a image on Facebook, it will, I can go to more details and it will tell me where things are laid. If there's a sun in the right hand corner, or if there's balloons ahead, so you can get more than the description that it generates automatically. So those are some of the other ones. And then if you pull a picture into, you know, Word or PowerPoint or whatever, it can try to do an automatic image description as well. So we've had some services before the, you know, the chat options came along.
So we have, I understand we have a lot of questions from, you have a question, but we also, okay.
Hi, my name is Paige. I was curious, in your educational experiences, either as a student yourself or if you have students, are there any assistive technology advancements that exist now that have been especially impactful in a classroom or school setting, or would have been especially impactful to your personal experience?
Anybody want to take that one? Can you repeat the question?
All right. So in your experience, either as a student or maybe a teacher of students, are there any assistive technology advancements that exist now that have been especially impactful in a classroom or school or learning setting, either currently or that would have benefited you, you know, in your earlier experience as a student?
So, you know, it's kind of interesting, at least at college years, this was when technology was taking still ramping up, but let's say if I was attending school still, you know, going to school is still challenging. And a lot of the things I find, or when I used to teach, is that some of these kids would come back with little knowledge of how to really use your screen reader. That was one thing. Another thing was just inaccessible content. So when you mix both, sometimes there's two things going on, and you know, unfortunately, that's sort of our world sometimes. And but you know, yeah. So screen readers have been just incredibly helpful, as we can all, you know, say. But as for new technology right now, I would say ChatGPT is really interesting to play with. And now if they could just fix their application a little, that'd be great. But sorry about that. Yeah, so new technology coming up, ChatGPT 4, just really amazing. So does anybody have? Go ahead.
Joe. So I was just going to say too, maybe we reduce it down like to two answers so that we can get to all the other questions.
So I'm not in college right now. It's been a long time, but I would like to add that, honestly, I'm not sure that it's making assistive technology better, although there is that. What's most important is making sure your content is accessible, because to put put the onus on the assistive technology to do the work that should be done by professors, by the universities, by the colleges, by the K-12 schools, that's what's really important, because we can have the most amazing assistive technology, but if your content's not accessible, it doesn't do us any good. So I think this is one thing that's really important. And I appreciate the question about the assistive technology, but sometimes, and this may just be from lack of experience from developers, content creators, teachers, professors, but they think that just because you have this amazing assistive technology that obviously you can just do the assignment, even if it's an inaccessible assignment. So that's just something to keep in mind.
Okay. And you said we have...
Yeah. So Amber asks, what are the most frustrating experiences when navigating a website or app, especially with something like insurance, healthcare, or other information heavy products?
Got a story about that. CAPTCHA, 5 months to fix a CAPTCHA. And this is, house insurance. So I mean, not house insurance, but house payments, just trying to make your payment. So you got to go through this sideway portal or whatever, instead of going in, creating an account, which you cannot create an account because you can't just call in. You have to go through their portal thing that has a CAPTCHA that you can't access. 5 months. Finally fixed. Maybe I'll just leave it at that.
Okay. And we're going to go ahead and go through the questions.
Okay, I'm going to unmute Carolyn again.
I just have another question. Sorry, I have non-Altex questions, but just especially with the whole panel here. As screen reader users, what's your preference for descriptions of race and specifically skin tone when race is unknown in alt text? Because I've seen Cooper Hewitt says you should say light, medium, dark skinned if race is unknown to decenter whiteness. But then I've also heard folks who don't like hearing that. So just as users, what is your preference? If race is unknown, obviously, if it's known, then you state it.
Oh, Joe.
So I personally like light, medium, and dark skin tone. I think that's actually good, even if you know this quote unquote race of a person, because people may identify as a certain race or ethnicity, but that doesn't mean that their skin tone matches whatever people think. It's all very stereotypical, is what I'm trying to say. So I think I like to know about people. I'm curious about visual details, so I think it's fine to describe, but I don't think that we need to go on and on about it. So light, medium, dark is good for me. Anyone else?
It's interesting that when people describe themselves too, I personally don't like doing that. I think it's really more about the person than the actual what is going on. So it's not information I really need. That's my take.
Yeah, I think it's all individual, but I'm with Joanna. You know, just a little description helps. If it's in an alt text, pictures, I think the light, medium, dark is good enough. In the iPhone, you know, in your little icons, it does that. I wish it would just let you do just the silly line drawing or whatever. I don't want to have to waste my time picking in there. Which one is it? Or, you know, but yeah, for your alt text, I think, yeah, that's good. And you're going to get everybody, you know, the gambit, you know, those that appreciate a description and those who don't really need a description.
Any question from the live audience? Or from
related comment? Oh. So I have a related comment, and it's about gender expression. So for me, what I've noticed lately is the audio description, oftentimes it stops saying a woman, a man, you know, it would just say a person, which is fine because we don't know how people identify, but I would like to know what they're expressing with their appearance, because is this person expressing as a woman or a man, or maybe, you know, non-binary? That would be nice. I honestly would find that helpful, but this is just my opinion.
George has his hand up.
It does depends on the setting, like how related to movies. If I'm listening to the audio describer, and I will admit, depends on the particular actress, if her voice sounds appealing, yeah, I want to know everything. So I found myself sometimes going Googling if I know the actress's name, what's the height, weight of so-and-so? So, because I want the real picture. You know, I want to be on that playing field like you guys. Y'all have the ability to look at the screen. You can tell if this person is very curvaceous or this person is very slender. A good example, I watched a Netflix series called The Night Agent. And throughout all of these 10 episodes, one of the evil persons, they kept describing the lady as the hazel-eyed female. And that's all they said. I don't know if the hazel-eyed female was somebody who was Mexican or somebody who was Caucasian. I don't know. You know, I don't have the ability to know if hazel eyes is limited to a particular race or not. And since they never spoke the name in all 10 episodes, we don't know what the person's name is. So I can say who played so-and-so in that role, because all the description says it's the hazel-eyed female. So I said a lot of stuff just to say it depends on the setting.
Well said.
Mark, do you have any?
Let's see. So this one was from Jane. I hope I'm not repeating, but it says, you listed an impressive range of technologies, much of which is sophisticated and expensive. How do you ensure similar access to these technologies for the people you work with through funding, training, et cetera?
Joe.
So the screen reader that I use at work and also at home is called JAWS. And we've talked about that a lot. You can actually get a subscription for it for a year for about $100, $120. So honestly, that's not super expensive. There is funding through vocational rehabilitation throughout the United States. And if people need help with that, they can go to their VR agency. There's also free screen readers such as Narrator and NVDA, non-visual desktop access. So there are lots of resources out there for people who are blind and don't have a lot of funding. As for training, there's also VR, and there are groups of blind people who are happy to share our skills, like the National Federation of the Blind, the American Council of the Blind. There's different groups out there where people just love to share their skills. So that's my answer. Any other?
I think there's Computers for the Blind. What do you say?
Use naming groups. IBUG is a group called iOS Blind Users Group. That's what it used to stand for. And they have a platform on Zoom where they have like various meetings throughout the week. And basically all they're doing is sharing information with beginners as well as experienced users on apps that are built into phones, as well as some third-party apps that people can inquire about, possibly downloading to enhance their independence. So yeah, there's very groups, and they even have like a mentoring program that someone is a beginning user, they can sign up with them and they will actually help them to learn all the accessibility features of like smart devices.
This is Kevin. I was going to say that a lot of the apps that we've mentioned today are free. Most of the ones that I think we've mentioned today, there are some paid ones, obviously, but the Freedom Scientific, the makers of JAWS, they have a great podcast. They put out training podcasts on different topics, and then they're also web series, so you can find them on YouTube. And then with the purchasing, like Joanna was mentioning, the Voc Rehab, and they can help. But locally here in Austin, the Austin Council of the Blind, we have an assistive technology grant where we can help people that don't have open TWC cases, or people who don't want to go to work necessarily, but just need to have a way to browse the web or whatever, but we can help them purchase technology, whether it's for personal use or work or education, if they don't have the resources.
Hi, this is Andrew. Also, a lot of universities or academic institutions will also be able to provide software for free, like JAWS or Fusion, Zoom Text. So you could also go on, if you're enrolled in college, definitely go and look at the software that's available to students, staff, faculty. I think everyone I've been a part of have offered JAWS and Fusion for free. There's also Texas Lending Libraries that you can Google. I know they're here locally at UT Austin, and they can also help find funding for you for assistive technology, just like the American Council of the Blind here in Austin and those chapters in NFB. So just reaching out to those local institutions. Also, all the Windows products come with Narrator already built into them. Same thing with Apple with a built-in voiceover. So you'll see that with Apple TVs, Macs, iPads, iPhones. With Windows, you see the laptops, even Xbox. You can even turn Narrator on with that as well. So a lot of stuff's already coming built in. And so it's going to be with that purchase or with that free item you get.
Any questions?
The next one was from Carolyn. For folks who use screen readers with PowerPoint, what are the most common accessibility issues outside of correct reading order, alt text, unique headings, et cetera?
I'm not sure, but I know one of the things that I face on websites and such is content that refreshes. You get into a website and it's always, you know, some banner is going or something that slows the whole thing down, or that's what I see is that when I have a problem with websites. Or maybe one irritating one is when you go to a website and a video automatically turns on, or music, you know, loud music, and now you can't hear your screen reader over the music of the website. So my workaround is I get to the website and I just select the entire page, copy it, and I paste it into Notepad so I can read it without the noise. So kind of those automatic things that I wish there was a little button or link that if you want that, you hit that. Otherwise, you can just get to it and it'd be just quick and easy.
Just add to the PowerPoint question. Joanna and I guess we were producing a PowerPoint presentation, and I was using animations, but we found that the animations aren't accessible. So what we did with that is that we just made another PowerPoint presentation, just took the animations off. And the animations I'm talking about where they slide in, or they not the transitions between the slides, but just the animations are happening on the slides as you press the space bar to go to the next, and things are appearing. So that was one thing that we ran into. And then just earlier this week, I worked with somebody remediating, and it was just five slides on PowerPoint. And one of the big reasons that it wasn't accessible, and you know, we talked about reading order, but it was flattening out the graphics. So what was happening is somebody had created a background that had several different geometric, you know, backgrounds. And so it was sounding, I forget what it was saying, but it was something that PowerPoint was naming it, and it would say it and say it and say it, and then you would get to the title of the slide. So that had to be, and what I mean by flattening is just taking it and taking a picture of it with Snagit, or what's the other one, Snippet, and make one picture of it. So now you have one, you know, all three parts are now one image that you describe. So that helps with the accessibility. Yes, sir.
Some other thing too, one other thing I thought about too, sometimes you could be on a website, and if you're filling out an application or you're filling out a form, and then you come to this part where they want you to say, prove you're not a robot, and they fail to put an audio option for the caption that you have to identify. And so now you surely have to rely on some visual eyes, because the option is not available for you to be able to name whatever the caption is in that box. If that particular developer had failed to give an audio option to say what was in there for us to type in to prove that we're not a robot.
This goes back to you that you're to follow up on your PowerPoint question and to ask a question. So the reason you're hearing those objects is because they just put them on the slide as an element rather than on the master page of that slide. So flattening or making that screenshot does the same thing, meaning it eliminates it from the screen reader, but the best solution would be to put it on the master slide so that it's not voiced at all. But I do have a question. So when it comes to artifacting or marking decorative items inside a PowerPoint, I've heard different theories on how to address that for a person who is natively AT user in a live PowerPoint file. If you mark it as decorative and check the box, I've heard it's very hard for an AT user to get to that object to figure out that it's decorative. But then other techniques are write artifact in the description. So when they hear the slide, they'll hear artifact. It seems odd in either direction, the solution. So I guess my question is, how would you handle artifacts? How would you want it to be handled when there's something that's purely decorative, but it's in a live PowerPoint?
Anybody have any? Okay, Joe?
So I think I'm understanding your question. I definitely would not want it to say artifact if it's just an artifact. First of all, that's not exactly plain language and people may be confused by artifact. Now, if you said there's a way to make it to basically artifact it and then it's hard to find it. Well, if it's hard to find it, it doesn't really matter because it's supposed to be artifacted. So that's my answer to that question. I'm not sure I totally understood the question, but that's the best.
You answered it correctly. That's what I want.
Okay.
Confirmation.
Sounds good.
Any more questions? We have about 6 more minutes.
Yeah, so there's a similar question here from Amber about what are the most frustrating experiences when navigating a website or app, especially with something like the insurance healthcare. Oh, wait a second. We asked that one earlier. Mm. My apologies. For a web or app links that open in a new tab or window, is it best to add text that notifies the user that a new window will open? Is a title of the link sufficient or a labeled icon that says external link opens in a new tab?
Joe.
This is Joanna. For me personally, I think it's best to have it in the link because sometimes screen reader users may bring up a list of all the links on a web page, and they may not even see that icon. They may not navigate to it, especially if they're using their links list. So I think it's best to have it in the link text.
Next question.
I must admit, I think that's the first time that's been answered just one way. A few folks have asked for clarification on a question related to preference for a date. Should it be March 2nd, as in S-E-C-O-N-D, or March 2-N-D?
Joe again.
Sorry. JAWS, if it says March 2, just the number, JAWS will read it as March 2nd, usually. So it really depends what you want it to look like visually, I think. Belinda?
Yeah, I agree. It's what is the format? What is the, how is it looking in print? You know, if you're adding ND in the alt text and it's not on the screen, sometimes, you know, I'm going to read the screen or like in Word documents where you have to go into a JAWS cursor to see what is really on the page and it looks different from the alt text. That's a little confusing. So I would match it and just whatever it is on the thing and just use true format, you know, don't put point dots or periods where they should be hyphens, that sort of thing.
Okay, thank you, Belinda and Joe. Any other questions? We probably have just time for
one more. Yeah, it's time for us to wrap up and close up.
Okay.
You have any last words?
Any last words? Anybody from the panel? No? All right. Well, thank you for attending.
Yes, thanks for attending. I'm going to put a...
Yeah.
Just like Chris said, thank you all. We really appreciate your attention and your work on accessibility. We all appreciate that very much. Thank you.
And we'll share a link and a QR code here. And if you would fill out the evaluation survey, we would greatly appreciate it. How is it? That's not sharing. I'm not sure why it's not. Yeah, just thanks.
Thank you.